Yep, that one's on right there. That one's on right there. Okay. All right, everybody, good morning, good evening, good afternoon, depending on where in the world you are. All right. Yep, we'll straighten out. Yep.
All right.
How's everybody doing? Happy Monday. It is 8 p.m., a little bit after 8 p.m., actually, but 8:03 Eastern Standard Time. Every Monday at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, that's exactly how it's supposed to work. Yep, that's a new feature. Mm-hmm. My name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, and do I get some water?
It does not help.
Oh, really?
I'm so sorry.
That sucks.
I have a serious problem.
What I do is I get dozens and dozens of emails a day, personal messages a day, Facebook message a day. Hey,
Argentina,
how are you? Asking me for help, and I can't do one-on-one help other than I'm doing my free Skypes, and I'm also doing, you know, obviously I do paid Skype, and I got a board and train up in Providence, Rhode Island. We specialize in challenging dogs, so a lot of aggressive rehab we do, a lot of behavior modification we do, but we're balanced trainers. We use everything from food and clickers to remote collars. We use actually a little bit of everything on almost every dog because we're trying to train yes and no. If you've never watched this show before, welcome. You get this really, really short answers. I cannot get into depth with each answer. Technically, every question is like a one-hour answer. I can't do it. It's almost like triage here. We believe in, you know, tons of exercise, good diet, train a lot of obedience work, but actually, you know, stopping bad behaviors. One of the things you're going to hear me talk about a lot on this show is punishment. The reason why you're going to hear me talk about punishment a lot is because nobody else wants to talk about it for some reason. And most people will ask me how to stop an unwanted behavior. So that's really, really important because stopping an unwanted behavior is, and the only way you can stop an unwanted behavior is punishment. If people say, oh no, no, you don't need to punish a dog. It's like, well, unfortunately, you know, you're, you know, lying, and it's unethical to say that you can positively reinforce something to stop an unwanted behavior. It doesn't work that way. So here we go.
Is there an e-collar for a 6-pound Bichon?
Now, that's a little bit of a pain in the butt. Some of the smaller breed dogs, to try to get a remote collar on them. I would use a mini educator. I would use a mini educator. You actually could use the vibrating one if you wanted to. That comes a little bit of a smaller box, but I would use a mini educator and then make a small dog contact point. Small dog contact point for that, and you can do that. Hey, everybody on YouTube, how are you?
Is there enough holes on the collar to?
Yeah, you could, or you, and I would put it on a bungee collar. So they make a bungee strap. It's an add-on. It's an add-on accessory. I would do that, and then yes, you can do that. Next, e-collar technologies, the Mini Educator 300. Next.
Thoughts on neutering? Will it help calm?
Neutering does not do anything but stop procreation. It's the only thing, trust me, I'm a huge advocate of spay and neuter, but it doesn't help behavior. It helps stop reproduction. Dog training, balanced dog training, creates calmness. So place command and downstays, having an on-off switch in your dog really, really will help doing that. So you can have, give me a room full of unfixed dogs and I'll have them calm in 30 minutes or less. You know, all of them. All of them. And that's not an ego brag. It's just the power of yes and no. So you're excited. I'll correct you for being excited. You know, you're running around. I'll stop you from running around. And then I'll tell you to be calm. So it's pretty simple to do. We do it at all of our seminars live right before your eyes, and all the dogs can do it. So next.
Okay. Peggy, thank you for the hair compliment.
Oh, awesome.
Monica, training border collie with clicker, bites finger, taking kibble from my hand.
Okay, what I want you to do is have a bonker. So you have a bonker, which is a rolled up towel. If you don't know what a bonker is, just, you know, Google.
You should have one. Maybe.
Yeah, just Google bonker, Gary Wilkes, and it's a towel. The dog, if the dog bites, goes to bite your hand, you would say no, one count, boom, punish the dog for biting your hand. Next.
What are some of your top things to know about dog behavior?
If you don't teach the dog no, you'll end up probably rehoming the dog. That's probably the number one thing. If you don't teach the word no, you'll probably end up rehoming the dog. That's the most important thing. Next.
Just bought our working spot for the Sussex seminar.
Oh, excellent.
Awesome.
Oh, who's
Delilah?
That? Is that Delilah? Delilah, remember, it was the location was just changed today. Check on that. This has never happened in over 100 seminars. The original location in West Sussex, we lost because the person that lived there moved. So there's a brand new location. So when you're booking your room, make sure that you recognize it, and it's listed now on today's rvdogtrainer.com. Next.
How should you start recall training with an 8-week Australian cattle dog?
What you can use is food. You can use food, and you can use a clicker if you want to. And what I would do is all their dailies, and I'm looking forward to seeing you, by the way. I was so focused on like the location because it just happened. Thank you so much for buying a ticket, and I can't wait to see you. I'm being sincere about that. What you're going to do is you're going to use a food, and you can use the dog's daily food, not treats, but the dog's daily food. And I've got a video called Come Sit Break. It's on my YouTube channel. It does not show with a clicker, but it just shows it using a verbal marker. But you can use a clicker if you want to. And it's all done with just the dog comes to you, it sits, you have kibble, you give the dog the kibble, and you just do that like 20 times per meal. The dog will understand recall as well as sit and break. And then you can also do it with, you'll be able to incorporate down and then place all before the dog is 12 weeks old. Next.
Do you have a special pool liner or filter for your pool because of the dog?
So the swimming pool at work is an Ivex pool, and that is there is no liner. The liner is the pool. So it's a really, really thick vinyl, and that just has a filter and a pump. The pool that you have at home, where you see all my dogs, all of my dogs in, as well as Angelo, Naked Angelo, that's a gunite cement pool. And that has got an upgraded filter, and it also has a pretty strong pump. But just stay really, really, really stick to the cleaning it daily. We've actually bought a robot. We bought a robot for the pool that goes in and cleans it every day. And we just got that this week. And boy, that's worth the it's worth $1,000 investment. It really is. Mm-hmm. Yep, next.
Thank you, Sarah, for the hair compliment.
Awesome.
My boxer is scared and barks and lunges, jumps around people only when I walk him.
Okay, so number one, what you're doing is, let's pretend the dog's not scared, okay? Let's take scared out of the equation, and let's just say your dog is badly behaved on walks. Let's keep it at that. Because what I want you to do is you're going to end up punishing that reactivity. If you're not familiar with the word punish, punishment does not mean abuse. And it's actually pretty bad that people are saying that. Punishment is punishment. And if you want to follow the science of dog training, it's included in the science of dog training. It's reward and punishment. So what you're going to do is make sure your dog's on a prong collar. Prong collars help you really, really give great information to the dog. Teach the dog how to properly heel next to you. If the dog gets reactive, you would correct the dog. You can use a bonker. So a bonker is a towel wrapped up. As soon as that dog starts getting excited, you would say no, bonk the dog, put the dog into a heel position. Always give information to that dog prior to it being reactive. Next.
We did the 180. It's worked great. Thank you.
Awesome. The 180 is a wonderful move. If you go to my YouTube channel, and if you just type in 180 move, it'll pop up. It's a video with myself and a Rottweiler, and we do that with a lot of dogs that are creeping a little bit ahead. They're not focused on the handlers. It's a great, great technique to use. Next.
12-week-old bites hair and doesn't let go even when corrected.
Okay. Well, you're probably not punishing correctly. So if it was a proper punishment, the dog would stop. The dog would stop. So number one, as far as it biting your hair, if you're talking about the hair on your legs, that makes sense because that's where the puppy is. If you're talking about your hair in your head, my question would be, how can the dog access the hair on your head? Why is your dog either up or why are you down so low? So what I would do is number one, again, I would use a bonker. Take a bonker. You would say no. You can also use a long hair sitting on the floor. Okay. So what I would do is you can use a pet convincer. Pet convincer is just, I keep looking for all these tools that I don't have with me. It's just compressed air. The dog bites your hair. No. Boom. Compressed air. All right. So let's do that. Next. But also maybe don't spend so much time sitting on the floor right now. Next.
King Canine is cracking me up. Just witnessed a dog-human bite incident, jumped into action Jeff G style.
Awesome. Good for you. Next.
My GSD isn't as good at recall as I thought after he ran off today. Any tips? Don't own e-collar.
Get yourself an e-collar or don't let your dog off leash. Bottom line. So unless your dog has got a really good recall, really good recall, you've got to keep your dog on leash because why? There's a lot of stuff out there that's more appealing to your verbal praise, your physical touch, you know, petting your dog, or the best, yummiest treats out there. There's plenty of things out there that are more important. So if you start your dog on remote collar training, you're going to be able to override all of those you know, outside stimuli, the environmentals that are out there. So that's the best thing you can do, or keep a long line. When you bonk a dog for reactivity, you throw the towel right on the dog's head. It's a towel. Mm-hmm. It'll never hurt the dog, especially a boxer. It's just not going to hurt the dog. Next.
My 3.5-year-old boxer acts very nervous when I walk him around people, only when I walk him.
So that's because the dog is restrained probably by a leash, and it can't flee if it wants to. And it knows it probably can't fight, which would be bite and lunge if it wants to. So what you're doing is you're dealing with a messy middle. So what I want you to do is this. I want you to make sure you advocate for your dog. I want you to make sure you advocate for your dog by making sure nobody comes and pets your dog. And you can also get the dog to look up at you. So every time the dog looks up at you, you can say yes. You can give the dog a little bit of a food reward. While you're actually on the walk, it's a little bit of pain in the ass to deliver food while you're walking. So, but you can just tell the dog good for looking up at you. And then you utilize space if you have to utilize space. Keep a distance from people if you have to. And then you can move all the way in. It all depends on how good your leash handling skills are. But the worst thing would be to have people come up to try to pet your dog or even give your dog, you know, food right now. Next.
Trying to teach dog fetch.
There's a great video out there. Look for something called forced fetch, F-O-R-C-E-D, forced fetch. Most hunter dogs, you know, they train that, as well as competition dogs. They'll train that as well. So I don't train fetch. My dogs fetch. I don't know how they do it. Yes, forced fetch. Yep. Next.
I'm really struggling to find dogs to work. South Florida shelters, private county, are not welcoming.
So most shelters are not very welcoming at all because they actually don't truly care about the dogs. And when I make a statement like that, I get a lot of negative comments to that. But it is a fact that your average shelter and rescue in the United States is against balanced training. They think by only saying yes and being nice to the dog with a little bit of fairy dust on top, it's not even about money. It's not about money. It actually isn't. It's actually about selfish human beings deriving pleasure by being rude to people and thinking that they're doing an act of kindness by just rescuing the dogs. So you rescue the dogs, good for you. Let's train them up now. I can rescue 1,000 dogs a week. That doesn't make me a hero. It actually makes me a fool. Train them. Train them, train them, train them. So what I would do is I would look for a small rescue. There are absolutely small rescues in every state that would welcome a balanced trainer. Next.
I don't know what this is.
How would you approach a 4-year-old puppy who is afraid and doesn't want to play with his...
I don't know.
Next.
Why does my dog keep eating its own poop when there's dog food on their tray?
Because, Al, it doesn't make a difference. Dog food, because why? I'll tell you why dogs eat poop. You ready? They enjoy it. That's it. The only reason why dogs eat poop is this. They enjoy it. There's no other answer. Everyone's going to try to give you this, like, scientific, you know, oh, it's because of an iron.
I don't know how they can like it, though. Why would they like that?
An iron deficiency in the dog's dog. Well, actually, 5,000 years ago, dogs ate their poop because they didn't want to leave any trail of it there for another predator to attack them. How about this? They eat it because they enjoy it. Ta-da!
Why?
So this is what you're going to do. Remote collar on the dog. All right? Remote collar on the dog. The dog goes to eat its poop. Correct high. Make eating poop unenjoyable. Guess what? The dog will stop. Next.
Can you recommend a dog training book?
No, I can't actually. This is what I recommend. I recommend working with lots of dogs. If you're just a private person, make mistakes with your dog. What I would do is I would actually recommend, I shouldn't say that. Sean O'Shea, The Good Dog Way. Right here. Mm-hmm. This is probably the best dog training book on the market. And it's not because it's my buddy, but this is such a great book. It's such a great book. We're going to start giving these away for every client of ours for free. All right? That's what I would start. But I would start by just working your dog. See what works for you. See what works for your dog. Next.
Oh, the 4-year-old is afraid and the puppy doesn't understand that his dad is afraid and doesn't like to play. The 4-year-old dog is the dad. The puppy's father.
Okay. The puppy doesn't understand that his dad is afraid. So what you got to do with that is you've got to advocate. So you have to advocate for the puppy. And you've got to advocate for the four-year-old dog. So then it's up to you, then you've got to move the puppy away from the dog or have them work in lower active environments. So if you ever see us do socialization with a dressage whip, you'll see us do, that's what we're doing. We're advocating for the dogs. So a lot of times puppies don't know. Puppies don't know. So if you don't keep advocating the dog, what's going to probably happen is the father is probably going to snap at the dog, which isn't the worst thing, because then the puppy would go, oh, now I understand what you mean. Next.
My puppy tends to get nervous around new people. How do I go about introducing her?
Well, how old is the puppy, number one? When you say puppy, everyone's got a different thing. If it's 12 to 14 weeks old, if it's up to 16 weeks old, I would use food, low pressure with food. But if it's, you know, some dogs don't you want to introduce them to people, you want to have them around people. So having a dog around people is actually really, really key. That's really, really important. So you work on existence first, then you can work on more direct interaction with them. That's what I would do. But if you've got a really nervous dog and someone walking up to it with food going, oh my God, I love you, puppy, that would freak dogs out. The best thing to do is actually ignore them. Don't go at them head on. Always have your side to the dog and allow the dog to approach you if that's how you want to do it as well. Also, don't forget on the replays, you can share this as well as right now. And you can share this by hitting the little button in the corner. And if you're not following me, you can follow me. Also, during the course of the show, you can always tap the hearts. If you don't like what I say, they don't have an F you emoji at all, but I guess you can just log off and don't watch me again. Next.
There's a middle finger one.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
What's the robot called, and does it work for underground pools?
It does work for underground pools. We do have an in-ground gunite pool at home, and it is called the, I don't know what it's called. Somebody mentioned it earlier. Is it the dolphin?
Dolphin or Polaris?
It's a dolphin. I think it's the dolphin. It's a dolphin, yeah.
It's funny because we used to have a shark.
Yeah, I'll take a picture of it tomorrow and I'll put it on my Facebook. I mean, I'll put it on my Instagram stories tomorrow. Check out my Instagram stories tomorrow and I'll take a picture of it with the model number. Next.
Thank you. The bonker fixed my other boxer who used to counter surf, only took two bonks.
Awesome. Good for you. Who's that, Steven? Awesome, Steven. Proud of you, buddy.
Marianne says bonker equals game changer for reactive locks, even better than e-collar.
Marianne, agreed. Game changer for you. Awesome.
Best place to bonk on locks for the side heel.
Steven, right in the head. Right in the head. Boom. Next.
Do you punish for licking?
Yes, I do. Yes. It's annoying for a dog to lick you. Next.
First time using prong collar on client's dog. Client thrilled with first comfortable walk ever.
Awesome. Congratulations.
Intro to former dog, human aggressive dog to other dogs per your exact protocol. Success.
Awesome. Coco, all right, Coco, congratulations. You know, I'm going to say this. You know, I had a radio show for 6 years, and I've been doing this social media platform for probably about 3 or 4. So we got at least 10,000 hours of my big mouth yapping away on Q&As, 80,000 posts on Facebook, 5,000 videos. This is not ego brag stuff. What it is I'm giving out massive amounts of free content to the marketplace. And I can't tell you how incredibly impressed and proud I am that the people that are actually taking this content, you know, sifting through all my content, seeing what works for them, applying it to their dog, seeing the progress, keeping up with it. And these are people like yourselves that I've never met before. We may never meet ever. I hope we do, but we may never meet. And that you're actually transforming your dogs and your lives for the better, all with free content. That's why when I see dogs out there that are badly behaved and owners say, we've tried anything, I'm sorry. I'm going to call bullshit on you. And I'm just as thankful as I am to you, as much as I am to anyone else calling them on their shit. Because do you know what I mean? Bullshit, you have tried everything. No, you haven't. I'll give you 20 things you haven't tried. And I'm not saying this to shame or blame or make you feel bad. I'm like, you're going to get rid of your freaking dog if we don't fix this. So here we go. Let's go. Try it. Next.
Do dogs ever doze off, wake up on mat, and forget whether or not they were told place?
They do. And if they walk off, just say no and put them back. They do, yeah. Yeah. I mean, here's, you know. So, hey, Heather. Next.
Forced fetch, you said?
Yes, forced fetch, just like it sounds. Yep.
Hey, y'all, can't wait to see y'all. Looking forward to training with Gary Willis.
It's going
to
be a good one. It's going to be a good one. I'll see you in a couple weeks. Next.
Here we go.
Shelters aren't welcoming. Yep, absolutely are. It's too bad.
See dogs in foster care for months or years with behavior issues because rescue not open to correction.
Yep, exactly. Really simple to do. Most rescues are doing, most rescues and shelters are literally doing the opposite of what you should do to train a dog. I've seen it. I see it. They're literally doing the opposite. They're making it worse. Next.
I see you're coming back to Chicago in October. Looking forward to another RV trainer session.
Awesome. Yep. I'll be in Chicago. It was just announced in Chicago. And then we're announcing, I just announced Indiana today too. So Indiana, I just announced. And I'm announcing Tucson, Arizona tomorrow. So here we are. I thought 2017 was done with seminars. Linda's not too happy about this. But we just announced Chicago, Indiana, and Tucson, Arizona, all in a week. Pretty good. Philadelphia, Heather, jump on a train, a bus, a plane, a car. September, Providence, Rhode Island. You're not that far from us. You really aren't. Come up Friday night, leave Sunday night. It's worth it. Next. But I won't be coming to Philadelphia in 2017, and I've got nothing planned for 2018 yet. Next.
What's your advice with dealing with a dog with toy aggression toward people?
In Elkhart, Indiana. It's if you go to rvdogtrainer.com, rvdogtrainer.com, you'll see where it is. Toy aggression, remote collar, have the toys there. Teach the dog the out command. The dog moves away from it. I've got videos on that. So you're punishing the dog for being aggressive. Next.
What's your advice with dealing with a dog with toy aggression toward people?
I just did that.
I thought you didn't.
No, I just literally said that.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, it's okay. Will it confuse a dog if I say a certain command and it doesn't sound exactly the same way each time?
Technically, yes, but probably no. Try to be consistent. This is it. The bottom line is this. If I call my dogs over to me and I say, never go to a dog park, the most toxic, dangerous places in the world. If I say down or frown or clown or, you know, gibby gone down and hooba dooba shown, my dog's going to lie down. Why? We've done it thousands of times. I only ask my dogs to do a few things. So, next.
Difference in teaching heel versus dog walking on a leash in heel position?
Difference in heel versus dog walking on a heel. It's the same thing, Chuck. I think it's the same. I mean, I'm not sure if I'm not understanding your question. Heel is heel, at your side, at your pace. No sniffing, no marking, no lunging, no barking. You know, next.
Thanks. Been working with my 6-month-old lab with your video since 8 weeks, and she is now off leash.
Awesome.
Train.
That sounds like a really good progress. 6-month-old dog off leash trained right now. That's impressive. Kudos to you. Somebody put their homework in. Somebody worked. So, you know, if anybody says to you, oh, you're lucky you got an easy dog. No. I put my work in. I've been busting my butt since I was 8 weeks old. It's work. Next.
2-year-old dog, fearful but reactive to people, will slip, flat collar, and prong does not faze him.
So this is the thing. Let's pretend the dog is not fearful. Let's take fearful out of it. And let's just say you have a reactive dog. Absolutely should not be on a flat buckle collar or a martingale or a harness because they will slip out of it. So as far as the prong not phasing the dog, it's possible that it's not being used properly, or what you're doing is you're giving information to the dog too late or too light. What I would suggest is this. When the dog goes into a fear stage, I would bonk the dog. Most people are going to say, oh my God, don't do that. It's going to have a negative association with humans. It already does. It's already afraid. Like, you're not going to mess the dog up. You're not going to make it more afraid. You're afraid of roller coasters. Can you become more afraid of roller coasters? That's like, whether that's applicable or not, I don't know. All I know is this. You're punishing the act of the dog, like, freaking out. Punish that. Put the dog into a proper heel and walk. We do it every day and it works. Next.
How long is your average bike ride with the dog?
With my dogs, I probably go anywhere. It depends on the temperature outside. It was in the 90s lately, so I didn't do much. I'll probably only go out for maybe, I don't know, 20 or 30 minutes. Nothing crazy. Could I go longer? Sure. Next.
What do you think about dog biscuits with THC for anxiety, or is that just a way to avoid discipline?
Margaret, I'm not against THC at all for dogs, but For anxiety, I would rather train the dog. I'm not anti-drug, but I would say that 90%+ of dogs that come to us on meds are get off meds and then train up pretty nice. So we look freaky because we are freaky. And for $49.95 a month, you can see it. No, you can't. You've been blocked. So you know what I would do is I would train up the dog first before you decided to go the med route. But anxiety, I think, is mostly training more than anything. Next.
My dog has almost been completely trained from your free content.
Oh, Caroline. Awesome. Proud of you.
Hi, Heather. How can I correct the chase reaction in my pit bull? I don't want her chasing squirrels or my cat.
So what I would do is this. You're going to punish it, and you're going to punish it hard. So it doesn't make a difference if it's a pity or not. All dogs, we punish the same for any sort of like cat issues or squirrel issues. And what you're going to do is this. You're going to put your dog into something called avoidance. So right now we want to do avoidance. And, you know, for something like that, because your dog could kill an animal or it could run across the street while it's chasing an animal. Once a dog is in high drive, say chasing a cat or a squirrel, obedience is going to go out the door. It really is going to go out the door. You know, even dogs with bomb-proof, they're not bomb-proof recalls if they can't proof them off of a cat, with really good recalls are going to blow right through a correction with a cat or a squirrel. So what I want you to do is right now, as soon as that dog alerts on a cat or a squirrel, correct high. You know, correct high. That's what I want you to do. Next.
My 9-week-old puppy knows sit and down thanks to your video.
Awesome. Keep going. Be careful. You're in the honeymoon period right now. I want you to keep going really, really consistently. Next.
What's the process with layering an e-collar?
So layering an e-collar, the way what layering means is you means you're adding it to the existing, you know, training that you've already been doing. So what you're doing is if you use a leash, any way you want to train it with a leash, whatever collar you want to do. What you're doing is you're doing your leash skills with your dog, and then you're adding the remote. The way we do the remote is with pressure on, pressure off. All my videos usually show that. So the what you're going to do is say you want to teach the dog to sit. So the standard way to teach a dog to sit is you can say sit, a little bit of leash pressure up, the dog's butt hits the ground, and then you let go of the leash. That means pressure. So you put pressure on the leash, pressure off the leash, pressure on, pressure off. With the remote, you do the same thing. While you're holding the leash up, you also engage the remote in a working level, which is a low level, continuous stimulation, and then you turn them both off when the dog sits. And eventually you phase out the leash part and you just use the remote. That's the layering theory. So it's all done on a working level and it's all done to teach. Next.
Best tips to introducing a new dog into your home. We have a 2-year-old American Bulldog mix, neutered male, who sometimes can be a little leash reactive, and are planning to bring in a bully mix, 2-year-old spayed female. Tips,
yeah. First thing I want you to do is don't get them to be friends. Don't have this fantasy that you want them to be best friends and like spoon together and take a picture and put it up on Instagram. Like, get that out of your picture, out of your mind right now. That's a really cool goal to achieve. But right now, let's keep them both alive and keep all the humans in the family unhurt. And that's not because they're bully breeds. I work with a ton of bullies. It's because they're just two dogs getting together. So the first thing you want to do is migrate. Migration is this: go for a walk. Then what you want to do is you want to get them to exist. Existence is stuff like down in place. So for instance, these two dogs right there, so we can get dogs that don't like each other to do the exact same thing. Because all we're asking them to do is go to place or go to a down. We're not saying you guys need to interact. So the first thing I would do with all your safety protocols is migrate, walk, two, exist, kennel them up separately in kennels, lots of structure, and no high level play at all inside. That's going to be all done outside. All right, that's the start. Next.
How to stop dog from wanting to go in and out constantly.
Stephanie, you've got a little child in your bio. Cute kid. If your little child opened up the refrigerator during dinner 10 times, go into the refrigerator, close the refrigerator. Go into the refrigerator, close the refrigerator. Go into the refrigerator, close the refrigerator. What would you do? That's the answer to your question. Next.
I'm so grateful for your big mouth. You've changed our lives and we'll still have so much to learn.
Coco, thank you so much for the nice words. And I have so much to learn as well. And I love being a student.
What should my dog know for the sports seminar? Nervous because we are still working on his leash reactivity.
Don't worry about that at all. It's ACOPE638. Don't worry about that at all. You'll be fine. Bottom line is this. I'll stop the leash. It's Michael's seminar, Michael Fraz's seminar. By the way, his working spots are sold out. They sold out today. He had plenty of audit spots still available. It's a really great, well-priced seminar. I'll get rid of the leash reactivity if I have to within the first 5 minutes. Don't worry about it. You'll be fine. Next.
I have worked with fearful dogs before. The hardest thing is to get people to stop feeling bad.
So Lisa, I agree 100%. You know, I believe that, you know, you have to, and this is the thing, it's human nature. So, you know, a lot of times with the way I talk, people are like, oh geez, all you like to do is punish dogs and you must not like dogs. It's actually the opposite. The motivation behind the work I do is my love for the human race. I am madly in love with people and I care about people so much. I don't want their dogs to create them any mental or physical pain. So the way that I can help people the most is by helping them have better behaved dogs. So that's my mission. So you're struggling with your dog, I can help you. So then what I do is no dog is turned in to a shelter for behaving good. Dogs are turned into shelters for behaving bad. Therefore, bad behavior has to be punished. But on the flip side, we train a ton of good behaviors. We fully off-leash, you know, we fully off-leash train dogs. We do that through positive reinforcement as well as punishment for non-compliance. So it's that's the balance of it. So that, I think, answers the question.
I'll be going to Indiana. I'm going to try my best.
Awesome. And Indiana sold out. Like we just did Indiana. A couple of weeks ago, and we just announced another one today. We had almost 50 people there. It sold out so quick that we decided to do another one, you know, right away. Next.
Just excitement, not aggressive.
Whether it's excitement or aggressive, I'm not quite sure what that, that excitement. Oh yeah. It doesn't make a difference. We still stop the excitement.
How's dog training in California? Is it competitive?
I mean, I think it all depends on what you look at as competitive. I mean, I think balanced dog trainers can do well everywhere. There's a big demand for really good balanced dog trainers. There's a big demand for averagely skilled dog trainers. I mean, if you can get a dog to walk on a leash, sit down, go to place, come back when you call it, go into its crate, come out of its crate, get rid of separation anxiety, you can make a six-figure income. I mean, it's not that difficult to do those things. So, you know, that's the thing. Next.
Your thoughts on two female bully breeds living together. I'm being told absolutely no.
One more time. Two female bully breeds. You know, this is the thing. Like, it all depends on you as your leadership skills. I mean, I think that two females, they can be pretty nasty. But then again, those are two females. All right. Those are two females as well. I think there's a lot of different variables to do. If you've got your heart set on it, it all depends on your skill level. It all depends on their behavior. It all depends on how much structure you put in. There's a lot of different things you can do. So next.
I'm curious how many Hawaii dogs you trained and adopted out this year.
Marianne, I'm not even sure. It's not a huge amount because we're in no rush to adopt them out. So in other words, I'm not looking for numbers. So right now we've got like two, and we're very particular where they go. And the reason why we're particular where they go is because we know our dogs are returned. So it's not a large amount. It's less than 10, I'll tell you that much. Because, you know, we're not a rescue. Like, I mean, I've got a small rescue, but that's not my gig. So my gig is doing very small amounts, off-leash training these dogs and then getting them adopted. So not a huge amount at all. My biggest value to the rescue community is all the free tickets that I give to my seminars and also all the free content that I give out. So, but we have one there now who's fully off-leash trained and actually went through trick training. Not that it needs to know tricks, but man, this dog is incredible. Next.
Teaching heel while in a wheelchair.
Yeah, what you're going to do with that is it's the same way. Heel is heel, so the dog just walks next to you. So we have a wheelchair at work that we teach dogs how to heel as well. So we teach them how to heel next to us. It's the same process. You just have to tell the dog where heel is, which would be, you know, a little bit away from the wheels and behind you. Next.
What is difference in no and wrong?
Wrong means keep trying, and no means don't do that anymore. That's at least my interpretation, but you can have your own. Next.
How do you deal with the don't worry, he's friendly off-leash dogs?
That's bullshit. My foot still goes out. Next.
How many times a day should you work with 4-month-old pup, and for how long each time?
So a 16-week-old puppy, you're probably looking at anywhere from 15 to 16 hours in a crate, not continuous, but over the course of the day. I mean, 8 to 10 hours overnight right there. Then you want to do probably half-hour training sessions, you know, 45-minute training sessions you want to do, and then you want to do some, you know, some structured walk, some obedience work, some socialization outside play, and things like that. Next.
Tips for pack walking.
If you want to walk, you know, if you want to walk all your dogs at once, a bunch of dogs at once, you want to master the single dog walk and then two dogs, three walk, and you're going to want all those dogs to be walking behind you. So all those dogs, you're going to want to be able to walk behind you. That's going to be the key to that. So a lot of that is based on your leash handling skills, your presence as a powerful leader. Dogs won't follow weak leaders. They won't. They'll follow a powerful leader. That doesn't mean you have to be yelling or screaming or being mean or being physical. It just means like strong presence. So next.
What do you do if a bonk or e-collar correction causes the dog to redirect onto you?
You know, then you would muzzle the dog. So you muzzle the dog if you're worried about that, but it rarely happens. And it's not the tool that did it. It's the dog going, I didn't like that. And it's not that they didn't like to be corrected. It's in general, the dog just was like, no, I get to do whatever I want to do. You can't stop me. Let me show you how strong I feel on that. And what do? They turn and they bite. So it's not because you shock them or hit them with a bonk or what you're not doing. It's that the dog is saying a big F you to you. Next.
Is it better to let the dog sniff around on a walk, or better to train it to be by your side?
I train heel, but you know, what I would do is we also give it some free time, potty time. And when you're off, the dog's off leash and it's free time, they can sort of do whatever they want to as long as they come back when you call. But all my walks are structured heels. Next.
My pit bull barks constantly when we have guests. We've tried asking guests to pet him, but nothing.
Okay, so I wouldn't ask guests to pet a barking dog. That's how you train barking dogs, by the way. So if I wanted to train my dog to bark, when my dog is barking, I would pet the dog or tell my dog to be quiet and pet the dog. And then what I've just trained is bark, quiet, affection. So don't get people to pet your dog, your barking dog. Train your dog to shut up because it's being rude. So what do you do with that? You have to punish the dog for barking. So what you can do with that is a bonker, which is a wrapped up towel. You would say no, throw it at the dog. But a remote collar would be best, and then teach the dog to go do an alternative behavior as well. Do not just teach the dog to do an alternative behavior. That doesn't stop barking. First you stop the barking, then you tell the dog what to do. So a lot of trainers will say, teach an alternative behavior. Okay, but if you don't punish barking, barking will never go away. Next.
E-collar brand. I have a sport dog, but now hearing about Mini Educator, worth it to switch?
So sport dogs run hot. So what I mean by running hot, level one is too hot. It's not like gonna, you know, it's not the most powerful feeling, but the way we train at lower levels before we go to correction mode. The sport dog is great to correct with, but I find that it runs a little bit hot for a lot of dogs. Some dogs it doesn't, but for a lot of the dogs that I would work with, you know, yes, it does. So I like e-collar technologies. Next.
Dog lunges when motorcycles are riding by. Any way to stop it?
Absolutely, absolutely. All that lunging stuff can be stopped with remote correction or a bonker. And what you're doing is at the first sign that dog shows arousal, correct. So the first sign that dog's ears go up, brow furrows, chest goes out, the dog's going, correct. You're correcting the arousal. Next.
Mine chased birds, put an e-collar on him once he understood it, ran after bird, high-level correction, fixed it in one go.
Yeah, there you go. That's usually what happens. Cool. Good job for advocating for you and the birds. Next.
How to correct for barking, whining, and crate when no one home, do not have e-collar.
But you need a bark collar for that. There's no other way to stop a dog, in my opinion. When nobody is home, how do you stop a dog from barking?
What about the whining, though? That won't help whining.
But the whining is, you know, the whining is buy yourself a bark collar. Get something called the bark limiter by Garmin. Bark limiter by Garmin. Don't put it on the vibrate. Do not put it on the A, which is the adjustable. Figure out exactly what level to put it on, and then knock on the door. If it barks and yelps but doesn't keep, you know, barking, then you've got the right level. If it keeps barking through it, the level was too low. Next.
Excessive barking when we have guests.
Punish the barking. Next.
How tight should prong collars be? Hard to see in the videos.
What I want you to do is it should be not so loose that it can move around. It should stay in place up high. Next.
Are the Springer collars you sell different from those on Amazon? I can't get your site to work.
My site works. People order stuff every day off my site. Go to solidcaninetraining.com, press shop. It should work just fine.
Letter K, number 9.
Yeah.
Not canine spelled out.
Yeah. So it should work. We got orders today. So next.
FYI, I made the switch from harness to prong collar, and it's changed our walks for the best. Thank you.
As it always, always, always will. Good.
Had to fight off a dog from my dog. Irresponsible owners had their dog aggressive dog off leash.
Okay, great. That's why you carry bear spray or a stick or your feet. Yep. Next.
New pup, 5.5 months, taught to pee pad in crate. How to stop pooping in crate?
You taught it how to go to the bathroom in the crate. So now you're trying to break a habit. So what you're gonna have to do is, I wish your dog was biting. I'd fix that quicker. You have to start all over again. All over again, you have to start. So what you're going to do is this. Obviously, no pee pads in the crate, really small crate so they can barely move around in. Put them on an intense schedule of food and water. Make yourself an Excel spreadsheet, days of the week, times of the day. Put that because you know when to go outside. Go outside to the exact spot every single time. Go potty, reward for going potty. You know, and then you're going to have to keep an eye on that dog. Keep an eye on that dog. So this is the thing, man. The dog was trained to go to the bathroom inside the crate, and it's been reinforced for 5.5 months. So you got your work cut out for you. Next.
You've helped me realize my dream to be a dog trainer, even as a wheelchair user.
Absolutely. There's plenty of dog trainers that can do that. Plenty. And you know what else? What I would do is I would learn, study clicker training, and you can actually start doing some service training work. Absolutely. Start doing some service training work, or what you can do is you can do so many different specialties. People that are in wheelchairs, people that are out of wheelchairs, but there's a huge market out there for service dogs, real service dogs, not fake service dogs, but real service dogs. And the sky's no limit. You know, you're just as able-bodied as anybody else. Trust me, you are. Mm-hmm. So most of my, you know, this is the thing is, think about the advice that I give out. I'm not walking around or standing up. Just think about that. Okay. And in a wheelchair, I can do just about anything with a dog. I probably don't want to wrestle too many aggressive dogs, but I probably still would with my skill set. But what I would do is you can probably do just about as much with any other dog trainer, but probably even better. Next.
LOL, my wife.
Because you've got better patience. Next.
LOL, my wife needs to see you guys. The dogs are her babies.
So Zeus, I hear you, man. I hear you. But the thing about this is, I get it, but they're not. They're dogs. You know, I think it's disrespectful to call a dog a baby. And I just think it's disrespectful. They're not. They're dogs. They're animals. And that doesn't mean we don't love them, but they're not babies. They're dogs. So, and people can say, oh, well, they're my babies. Well, they're not, though. They're dogs. Next.
Referred client to you for board and train. You told her you don't train for dog parks. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. If that's their goal, to go to a dog park, we tell them not to hire us. Next.
Tips for walking two large dogs on a leash.
Well, master one first, right? So master one of the dogs, teach the dog how to heel next to you and a proper heel. And then at the beginning, what you can do is if you feel more comfortable, one on each side, but it's so much easier to have them both on one side. So if you go back to some old pack photos of me, I had 14 dogs on Blackstone Boulevard. We're talking about, what is that? 14 dogs, probably almost 1,000 pounds of, that's like 500 kilos it's about 400, 50 kilos for all my metric folks out there. So next.
Your videos have helped us so much with our first dog. So clear and concise. Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. Thanks for the compliment.
How long a wait to book a boarding train?
Okay, right now I think we're at 4 weeks. So we're always at about 4 to 6 weeks. So if you wait 3 weeks, you still got to wait 4 weeks after that. So the way you do that, okay, is you just, you know, you go to our website and you fill out a form, and then I'll call you up personally. We'll talk about different options and then level of expectation. And then, you know, and then from there, we take it from there. Jessica does, my office person. Next.
Dogs should only be excited to pleasure you by obeying, my opinion.
Okay. Cool, Harrison. Always love your input, buddy.
I lost my connection. Don't know if my question went through. Really wanted your words on that.
Lucy, I'm not quite sure either. You can either watch the replay or try asking the question again, and if we get to it, we do. Next.
It's like 200 questions. Jeff from YouTube, I taught two of my dogs in less than 10 minutes to enter and exit the pool and swim like pros.
Awesome. Yeah, so what he's referring to is a lot of people struggle with swimming their dogs. I've got a video on YouTube, 3 good videos, in-ground pool, in-ground pool, above-ground pool, in a lake, ocean, stream, and you can get your dog to swim in about 5 minutes, even the most fearful dog. Yep. Next.
Videos from you, Sean, and Tyler Muto helped me revive my passion for training, now on a business.
Awesome. Good for you. No reason why you can't do it. It's a great time to start a dog training business.
Correct separation anxiety for dog and crate. Doesn't like being left alone when I take the other dog.
Yes, correct it. Tough shit if the dog doesn't like being left alone. Next.
I really wanted to know a brand name of an e-collar I should use and who is best to teach and show me.
So e-collar technology is a really good company, and watch my free videos. Next.
E-collar for a 15-pound senior dog?
Yep, mini educator. Next.
What level would you use for act of God for this size?
The right level. The right level. All depends on what you're trying to stop. So if you're trying to stop dangerous behaviors, you're going to go up for the highest level. So remember, it's just a number. It's just a number. So next.
I don't know what I'm doing. So nice to keep that going, though. The Hawaii people must be special.
Yeah, they are.
You.
Yep, they very yep. are. They're very special. Yep, they're very special. It's a wonderful program we're doing. Thank you for the recognition. Next.
What was the name of that dog training book?
The Good Dog Way. Go to thegooddogway.com. Love them by leading them. Next.
My dog is calmly in place in the other room, thanks to you, Jeff.
Awesome. Proud of you. Next.
Talk about training Basenjis. They have a reputation for being very difficult to train.
Basenjis train up like any other dog. I think that, you know, a Basenji is a dog, and the cool thing is they don't bark much. And what you can do is, if you learn how to motivate them, what's their yes, what's their no, you can get them to do whatever you want. Next.
I don't doubt your omniscience about dogs, but punishing for fear is counterintuitive for me.
Bo, then don't do it if you're not comfortable with it. We do it all the time, and it works. The dog is in a state of fear. You're not going to be able to – you can't positively reinforce the dog out of that. I'm just telling you what we have done thousands and thousands of times, Bo.
Yeah. I have to use a dictionary for that question.
So yeah, thousands and thousands of times. So all I'm telling you from years of experience, and someone will say, well, I've got years of experience and that's not true, but have you ever done it? That's the question. And did you do it right? That's the question. We've done it right, and we get these dogs out of a fear state. I know you believe me, and you're right, but it is counter, oh, let me get the dictionary. It is counterintuitive. How do you spell intuitive? E or I? So, you know, that's the thing.
That wasn't the word.
That's the thing. Oh, next.
Omniscience.
Next. That word, I don't know what it is.
Oh, next. So for healing the two dogs, heal on left side both. How to determine which dog goes on outside?
It's up to you. I would put the one that's a little bit more challenging on the inside. Next.
Correcting the fear is the only way to move them through it.
Yep, exactly. Next.
On it. Interesting. So all these people walking their dog with it in the front are wrong.
Zeus, if you're talking about the pack walks, I'm not going to call it wrong. I'm just going to call it, it has no value in my life. So walking a bunch of dogs, being led by those dogs for a dog sled team, that's what you want to be doing. For, you know, pulling a bicycle, that's what you want to be doing. For pulling you on cross-country skis, that's what you want to be doing. For walking around a neighborhood, I can't imagine a worse nightmare. Next.
How to teach it down to an adult dog who is not food motivated.
Samantha, you can use the dog's daily kibble if you want to, or use leash pressure. And I've got videos on how to do that, free videos on how to teach dog down to a dog. Next.
My mom's dog is so hyper and doesn't listen. She begs for food and will just sit there and stare at you.
So Ashley, correct the dog. So, excuse me, correct the dog. So this is the thing, is what I want you to do is teach the dog place. That's place. All right, next.
Lucy, the videos would be on YouTube. Is this a meeting for a certain group?
Nope. Dog Trainers Anonymous.
I'm going to be starting dog training school in a few months. Very excited.
Awesome, Lucy. Good for you. Just make sure that you don't just do what that dog training school tells you to do. Constantly be educating yourself with seminars and trial and error and find different people to watch train dogs and go to a cup, maybe even go to another school after your first school. So just remember that. Next.
Love that I always learn something more no matter how many times I listen to you.
Oh, thank you. Next.
How to start.
No. $3. Yep. Yep.
Do you want
that? Yes. Yeah.
How to start protection bite work for an adult dog.
So Samantha, what I would do is I would look up a sport dog trainer. I would look up a sport dog trainer and I would ask their advice on that. That's not my level of expertise at all. You can start watching a video on how to play tug. Start with that if you want to. But I would look for a sport dog trainer in your area. And there's usually sport dog clubs. And what you can do is you can go there, find out even if your dog is the right mix for that. Maybe it doesn't want to do arm bite sleeves, or maybe it's not the right temperament for it. But any decent decoy can usually get the best out of your dog. Next.
How to teach give.
We use the word out. And we do that with a remote collar, and I've got a video on that. Next.
Whining is the hardest thing I have trouble with.
Yeah, whining is with a remote. Yep.
How long does a messy middle typically last? Seems like it's been a couple of months.
Tony, it all depends on the dog. All depends on how much. All depends on what the dog is struggling with, but it also depends on you, the handler, if you're affected by the messy middle and you're feeling bad about the messy middle. And it depends on how well you are working the dog through the messy middle. So that's there's no technically answer to that one. Next.
Same for the harness to prong change. Thank you so much for the excellent videos.
Awesome. You're welcome. Let's get through some of these.
Suggestions on videos or books on understanding dog body language?
Working dogs. The best way to do it is working dogs. A lot of the pictures are taken out of context. I can't tell you how many times somebody has seen one of my dogs and say, oh my God, your dog is nervous. And I'm like, no, my dog is excited. Well, your dog's going to bite. No, my dog is excited. Ooh, your dog's making whale eye. I know. I'm standing to the right of my dog, and the camera person is standing in front of my dog. Like, you get so much gets taken out of context. Or, oh my God, look at that dog's, you know, tail. It's down. It's like, it's always down. Like, there's so much is getting taken out of context. So what I would say is work with tons and tons and tons of dogs. It's the best way to do it. Next.
6-month-old Rottweiler on prong doing well. Okay to roughhouse with him?
Alex, what I want you to do is this. Teach the dog how to play tug. Use one tug item. That's it. Put it away. Nothing else is tug. Not my sleeve, not my jacket, not my pants. Just this tug item. Teach the dog to bite it. Teach the dog to let it go. Roughhousing is done on your terms and your terms only, and the dog has to have an off switch. So we'll roughhouse, and now we're done. Next.
Are you coming to the WDC area?
Virginia. Yeah, I'm going to be in Virginia. Richmond, Virginia. Go to rvdogtrainer.com. Richmond, Virginia. Very close. Next.
How would you approach a dog that is trying to attack you?
I wouldn't approach it. I wouldn't approach it at all. I mean, if you're talking from a dog training standpoint, or you're talking from you just walking down the street, if I was walking down the street and a dog was rushing me to try to attack it, what would I do? Anything and beyond to neutralize the threat. As a dog trainer, what I would do is I'd have a leash on the dog, and most likely if it just came in, it would have a muzzle on it. It would have a muzzle on the dog. The first thing you need to do is you need to get a muzzle on that dog, though. And then once the owner leaves, and once the dog has spent, you know, an hour or two decompressing in a new environment, the dog becomes much safer. And once the dog has got, you know, training equipment on, and how do you do that? Sometimes you have to muzzle up the dog. So we can muzzle up really aggressive dogs. It takes two of us to do it, and it's not pretty sometimes, but any dog that's human aggressive should be muzzle conditioned before it comes into the training center. So we deal with some really nasty biting dogs. Next.
I'm new with you, Jeff. So far, you've made me a leader with my dog.
Oh, Gregory, awesome. Cool.
How can I stop my Yorkie from barking when the doorbell rings?
What I would do is get a bonker. A bonker is a wrapped up towel. The dog rushes towards the door barking. You say the word no. Wait 1 second. Whiz the towel at the dog hard. You won't hurt the dog. You won't hurt the dog. It's a towel. You'll startle the heck out of the dog. The dog will run away, but guess what? The dog will shut up. Next.
Are Belgian Malinois typically afraid of water?
I think a lot of dog breeds are concerned, nervous about water, even labs, but it's easy to train them, and I've got 3 good videos on my YouTube channel. Next.
Help with thunder anxiety?
Thunder anxiety, what I do with that is I actually correct the movement of fear, and then I reinforce the down or the place. So if the dog is running around all spastic, I actually punish that. Again, people will struggle with that. Oh my God, the dog's afraid, you're punishing it. I'm punishing the act of, dogs can break through a window. Dogs can eat through walls when they're afraid of stuff. It's actually really dangerous. They can break out of crates and destroy their teeth. So they can do a lot of bad stuff, harmful stuff to themselves. So the first thing I do is I neutralize all of that with a bonker. No, the dog goes, oh shit, I guess I shouldn't be running around. Then I say, place. They can go to place and they can learn how to start, you know, coping with their fear in a healthier way. Next.
How do you get my Belgian to drop a tennis ball in my hand or close to me? Usually it's 20 feet.
So what you do is you would have the dog recall to you and then teach it out. You can have the dog on a leash and do it. If the dog drops at 20 feet, you don't pick it up. Game's over. So teach the dog how to do a recall. So what you can do is, again, you can play forced fetch, which teaches the dog to hold on to the object until it gets right up to you, and then you give it a release command, and the dog releases it. So you want to probably look up forced fetch as well. Next.
How often would you put high-energy 6-month dog on treadmill?
Harrison, all depends on the breed of the dog and the growth plates. I would want to make sure you don't run that dog too hard. But and also make sure that the treadmill deck is long enough so the back legs are not coming off of that. But then again, if you let that dog loose in your backyard, it would run around like crazy for 20 minutes, right? So I think, you know, if you did it in 5-minute increments, you'd be great.
If I get an audit spot, can I upgrade it if a spot becomes available for the sports seminar?
Yes, you can, but it's highly unlikely that it will. Because we don't give refunds for any of our seminars because the tickets sell out so quick. It's like a concert or an airplane ticket or anything like that. But you're going to learn a ton by being an audit, a ton. Next.
5-month Aussies started barking in public at strangers, been socialized all most of their lives.
Yeah, it's going through a different stage of its life. It's sort of found. And bonker. So it happened. That's all dogs go through those stages. You hear that a lot. Next.
Spent almost 18 months using BAT with my fearful dog, was successful, but wish I found you first.
So there you go. BAT works, but it takes 18 months. So a BAT protocol, just look it up. To me, Maria, that was cruel and unusual punishment to you, you know, in my opinion. You know, in my opinion. In my opinion, that was really mean of a trainer to have you do that. So BAT takes a long time. What we can fix in a day, I don't know what Maria's issues were, but I've seen the BAT protocols for different things. What we can stop in a day or sometimes a week takes months to do with BAT. Why? Because they don't want to punish a dog, but they are being punished. Your dog was punished for 18 months by it not being fixed. I'm not shaming, blaming, or mad at you. You know that, right? You're sitting there going, duh. And you were punished. You had to spend so much time on these damn protocols that they might not have worked even after 18 months. You know what I mean? It's ridiculous. Next.
I've grown so much from putting out free content. Literally couldn't thank you enough.
Oh my God, Sarah, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your kind words. I can't wait to go to your seminar.
Oh, Lucy, excellent. And just go to rvdogtrainer.com. Next.
Looking forward to Providence Pack Walk this Saturday. Thanks, Solid Canine
Staff. Oh, yep.
Awesome, Heather.
Yep, you're welcome. You'll have fun. Next.
How would you introduce a new dog to a home with a 15-year-old dominant female?
Carefully, and I'm being serious. What I would do is, you know, I don't care if that dog is dominant or not. It has to accept other dogs in your house. So that's where your leadership skills have to come in. So I sort of answered the question a little bit earlier about how to introduce dogs. Next.
Hi, I love your video with Enrique doing bite work. Simply awesome.
Yeah, that was great. Yep, Enrique is skilled. He's got skills.
Tug is an amazing outlet.
Absolutely is.
Mm-hmm. How do I use the e-collar to train my dog from barking when we walk around other dogs?
You want to stop your dog from barking, or you just punish your dog with a remote collar. So higher level, correct. If you've got a lot of questions, you can do a private Skype session with me. So keep in mind, this is how I actually make a living. Let's, you know, keep in mind. So what you can do is we have to actually stop. It's an hour now. So we're all done with today's show. Obviously, we've got 288 messages that we have not gotten to. I apologize. We get through as much content. Let me just get rid of this person here. Mm-hmm. You can do a free 15-minute Skype session with me. Information is on my Facebook page on a desktop or laptop, not from a mobile phone. There's a bunch of tabs, and one of them says free Skype. Or if you've got so many questions, you actually can hire me. And I don't do these to recruit business, this is exactly how I make a living, by actually doing question and answer for people. So I look weird. That's because I am weird. Keep Providence weird. All right. So
get rid of this person.
What?
Like, get out of here.
Okay, there you go.
Thank
you. All right, everybody. So Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training. You can go to solidcaninetraining.com, learn more about our company and the work we do. Go to rvtraining.com. And also I've got a social media company called Jeff Gellman Media. You can go to jeffgellmanmedia.com as well. Thank you, everybody. It sounds like a lot of people are making a lot of progress. Super proud of everybody. And stay tuned. Tomorrow morning, another free Skype. And I got I'm not going to see most of you until next Monday. We'll have a house in Florida. Tune in this weekend. I'm going to have pictures of the new house. So nice 3-bedroom, 2-bath swimming pool in Bradenton, Florida. Nice. Oh, yeah. Nice. So I'll put pictures up. I'll give you guys a virtual tour on Friday night. We close on Friday. All right. Stick up for your husband. Yeah, she does.
I do.
She does. It's no big deal.
But still, get them out of
here. I do.
Why keep them around?
I know. That's true. I know. It was no big deal. All right. All right, everybody.
Good night.
Turn off YouTube. Good night, YouTube.